In the last video I did on Thurber's law, I said I would do a later video discussing how the formula was derived. This is that video. The math used is relatively basic calculus, and I will not describe the basic mathematical concepts used, though I will link to other videos that do. The law is derived from three main equations. The balance of trade equation. The first equation is that exports are equal to imports. Here, capital X and M are the values of exports and imports in real terms, respectively, and capital R is the exchange rate between the two countries. Remember that if we are talking about real terms, we mean that the terms have been adjusted to account for inflation, and so the effects of price changes have been factored out. This balance of trade equation is based on the assumption that in the long run, trade is balanced. Of course, trade may not always be balanced, as countries can sometimes borrow money in order to import more than they export, or vice versa. However, as a long-run approximation, balanced trade becomes more probable, as trade imbalances are unlikely to grow indefinitely. The import and export demand equations. The other two equations in the model are the demand for imports and exports in an economy. Imports are modeled as a function of domestic income, capital Y, and the real exchange rate, while exports are modeled as a function of foreign income, capital Y star, and the inverse of the real exchange rate. The specific functions we use are: these are used because they create mathematically simple solutions, which are theoretically intuitive, and are accurate enough to remain widely used. However, some later papers have replaced them with more complicated alternatives. Elasticities. It is easy to get an intuitive sense of what eta, pi, eta star, and pi star represent by taking relevant partial derivatives. So, for example, to understand what pi represents, we take the partial derivative of imports with respect to domestic income. This just means that we find how much import demand changes given a small change in demand. Next, we split the domestic income term into domestic income to the power of pi and domestic income to the power of minus 1. Now, from our initial equation, we already know that imports equal A times the real exchange rate to the power of eta times domestic income to the power of pi. So we can replace that term. Finally, solving for pi gives. This concept is known as elasticity. In this case, the domestic income elasticity of imports. If we repeat the process with the other exponents, we get that pi star is the foreign income elasticity of exports, and that eta and eta star are the relative price elasticities of imports and exports respectively. Finally, A and A star are simply constants with no important theoretical interpretation. Solving for proportional growth rates. These equations all refer to static values. We need to transform them into equations which refer to growth rates. These are not simply the rate of change of the variables with respect to time, but rather the percentage change. It is much easier to understand that exports increase by 5% each year than that exports increase by 50,000 coins worth each year. To do this, we use a special type of differentiation called logarithmic differentiation, where we take the logarithms of both sides of the equation before differentiating, beginning with the balance of payments equations. So, using the natural logarithm, ln, and the log rule, log of A times B equals log of A plus log of B. Using chain rule and the differentiation of logarithms gives. Using m prime to denote the partial derivative of the variable with respect to time. Finally, we note that the rate of change of imports over imports is the proportional or percentage change of imports, and replace this with the lowercase letter m, and we do the same for the other variables. In equilibrium, the growth rate of imports is equal to the growth rate of the real exchange rate plus the growth rate of exports. Repeating the same process for our import and export model, we get. Here, we replace Y with YB to show domestic income growth, which is in line with balance of payments equilibrium. Finally, we solve for y, b. Simplifying assumptions. Finally, we assume that eta plus eta star minus 1 times the real exchange rate growth is approximately 0. There are mixed findings on whether this is actually the case, but empirical work by Setterfield has shown price changes have a much smaller effect on trade than income variables. This corresponds with some important heterodox theoretical claims. International markets are much more responsive to changes in export quality and the type of exports produced compared with minor price changes. And the real exchange rate is relatively constant. That is, the amount of orange goods which can be exchanged for one teal good remains stable, even if the amount of orange coins which can be exchanged for a teal coin varies. This variation is often offset by differing inflations in orange land and teal land. This gives our final form of Thurl's law. The balance of payment constrained income growth rate is equal to foreign income growth rate times the income elasticity of exports over the income elasticity of imports. If you've got to the end of this video, thank you for watching. I know this was a bit of a more technical one. If you like this video, please like, subscribe, and comment, and check out some of the other videos on my channel.